Thank you for coming. I'm Frank Conrad. I'm working as an architect at appemeyer.com. I co-founded two companies in Germany, and then I worked a lot with American companies. I'm doing online advertising for more than 15 years, and my passion is large-scale, low-latency processing stuff, and do this worldwide distributed. And the motivation for the talk today is basically a piece where we were thinking of or had to design a system which run external untrusted code in Spark Flink clusters in a multi-tenant environment with very huge difference of job characteristics, small ones, big ones, lot of memory, a lot of CPU and such a stuff, and they want to have relatively predicted runtimes. And the infrastructure was said, okay, let us do this on Kubernetes because there's also a lot of other stuff which needs as an infrastructure around the system. And it makes us give us a good flexibility because it includes, as you have heard in other talks, the container, the deployment stuff, the orchestration you can have in clouds, really dynamic clusters. It fits good to CI/CD stuff, trying things out, and helps also to leverage really the scale of good MapReduce jobs, or which follow this pattern and do a good scale there. And this was also a point for us is to be provider vendor agnostic so that we have a chance to do a deployment also if we change our cloud provider. Point was also that we really want to dynamically scale up and down and leverage that you only pay by use of resources. And yeah, it allows, because of the deployment, also good version handling and integration. The jobs, as I said, is, they are really widespread in requirements of memory, CPU, and storage. Working with very different SLAs, some say, okay, they could be restarting many times. Others say, no, they should never. They should have very predictable run times. There was a lot of discussion, oh, how I can update Spark and Flink, how long I can run old versions of things because customer don't want to change their code. And there's also a lot of discussion about weekly, monthly processing, reprocessing, catch-up things, you know, everything what you disrupt your typically normal day schedule stuff. For the biggest challenge in this way we were thinking was really the multi-tenant stuff, which needs a lot of isolation on a UI API stuff at the runtime. At the network, Kubernetes don't have it by default. You have to use the extensions like Calico, which then really allows to isolate stuff, isolation on storage, where we'll hear some limitations, how to do logging, monitoring, and security. And here are some of the challenges what you will face if you start running such a thing like Spark Flink in Kubernetes. You see the effects of you run a cluster manager inside a cluster manager. So if you you will have some problem to leverage the different job size and really scaling the things up and down. Then one thing which is relatively specific to Kubernetes and the way how they are thinking is you get a lot of restarts. So it's because of scheduling things, because of update stuff and so on, Kubernetes is from a Spur point of view, say I have stateless apps and I can restart them as often as I like and to do optimal scheduling. But you will have challenges with that. Also, the rolling update stuff because Flink, Spark, the things is, if you run a job, typically it's designed to have one, two node failures, but not have a rolling update, which has then typically a huge impact of your runtime. The multi-tenant support itself from Kubernetes is currently very basic. There's working groups working on that, but it's really something what needs to be coming up. And also with the a lot of patterns, what you then see that you get also immutable system images. So basically every security update, or we restart all our instances, which has also the consequence that your applications get restarted and redeployed. There's also an interesting stuff what I've heard a couple of weeks ago, that guys doing, saying, even I restart everything every 60 days at least to make sure that I can deploy everything, which makes the things, make your system at the end more stable, but it has issues, produce issues because of the restart. So one solution to it is was the change of thinking and saying, okay, we not have a cluster and run there multiple jobs on it, a Flink cluster or Spark cluster. We basically say we create on demand a cluster and run exactly one job in it and scale it, the cluster in the way how you have the need for the job. Because if you want to deploy something in Kubernetes, you have to write a couple of YAML files or use a template engine Helm to do the whole orchestration stuff. And if you have written such a Helm chart, there is nothing stopping you to do two, three deployments with the same chart, but only different parameter. Name the cluster, for example, different. And if you have your size of the cluster as a variable, you can change it. So it's you have it basically really, really out of the box. And the whole stuff that you have your monthly, and it takes normally forever, then you start a separated cluster for that, run this job in a separated cluster, and because Kubernetes supports autoscaler, the Kubernetes cluster will automatically request new instances from Amazon, for example, to run this, to basically get the orchestration and so on. Really done, you need to add basically a write and helper app, which then do the creation of the cluster, submitting the job to your temporary cluster, monitoring the job, and do the reporting and integration stuff to your higher level workflow engine, like Airflow or whatever you are using to do the orchestration of multiple jobs. And for us as a multi-tenant, was also important that we can do their separated proxies for UI, API, to give this basically them access. So the pros are really this way. That, you get a good separation of the jobs. You get really dynamic clusters if you are in a cloud, if you can afford this resources. You can do really any tuning because you create a cluster for exactly your job. Because it's a cluster per job, you can easily run different versions. You only reference a different image, there's a different version of Spark Flink or your app in, and you redeploy it. That is basically the thinking, okay, my job is now a virtual kind container things. And the other piece, what also the helper app can help you to address certain issues, what you see in Kubernetes, like the drains or and so on, and it can follow the operator pattern, where I come later to. There, but there's no free lunch in this way. There are problems or challenges with that, which is clearly the startup time depends on how fast you get the resources from the cloud provider. If you have an existing cluster, there's nothing to do. Your job start fast, but here it will be depends on your cloud provider. You will be have some resource overheads for the infrastructure processes from running Spark Flink clusters, but there's you can limit them. I come later to that. You have to develop the helper chart, the helper app, and the Helm chart to do the deployment, and you have to have no free HDFS for and shuffling stuff, what you typically have if you have started your own cluster piece. There is basically in the new Spark version a first version of such a helper app in, which is not so good for multi-tenant users, so we was not able to use it, but it's really, for the most use cases, a really a starting point. So it's basically deploys the temporary cluster. You even don't need to write a Helm chart. It runs a driver, and you run your Spark job really on demand on the Kubernetes cluster. And for many reasons, for many things, this is sufficient for this. The helper app is I see really as a controller of your job and the integration with the higher level workflow engine piece and do the orchestration inside for running this job. It can be also if you have Flink long running stuff and you have the requirement that your instances needs to be restart because of an operating system upgrade or whatever, you can build in there some support. Okay, I suspend the Flink job, everything gets saved, get restarted, and after that you can do a resume. Because you don't have really a built stores stuff, you can trigger other on-demand resources. I come later to kind of on-demand HDFS, and this app could follow also the operator pattern, which is a stuff really to put additional knowledge into the Kubernetes system via this pattern. As I said, in our case, we had to write our own Helm chart, which basically produced via the template engine from Helm the needed configuration files and also produce other dependencies or do the connection like Zookeeper or whatever other stuff you need to deploy, and you have there all possibilities what you can do with your current version of Kubernetes you use. Also, if you need persistent storage, temporary storage, the things, you can all define this, and Kubernetes will take care that the stuff is working. So that's really a simple piece. And then, good piece. Kubernetes autoscales. This is, I think, the important part here is if you run it in a cloud environment with the cluster autoscaler from Kubernetes, you can grow and shrink your Kubernetes cluster. So if they get more stuff needs to be deployed, they automatically request new instances with certain specification, start them, make them available, and deploy your pods to that. And with the mechanisms of labeling and annotations, you can really play also with different instance types, which have different CPU memory things. They have local storage, no local storage, and all this kinds of thing, and you can really group this. And because it reflects at the end in a kind of in a cloud autoscale group, you also you should make sure that they can really scale to zero instances, and that the scale, especially the scale down, has a speed which makes sense for you. Depends on how fast you start the next job. If you have a queue, that you not shrink and then start again, which would raise your latency to start the next job. This is really something what needs to be considered, but you can really run, you get your dynamic Spark cluster or Flink cluster in this way. You still can't change this inside the job, but for two different jobs, you can really have something differently. So there are some things where you need in Kubernetes to look to run it in a stable manner. So if you want to have predicted runtimes, means that the job every time runs in a similar time if they have the same data, it's really set CPU, requested CPU and memory equal to the limit, because with that setting, Kubernetes guarantees you that you get this, and that you also only get evicted for things if you and you are not not can get evicted because somebody else behaves bad, because it's a shared cluster, the other pods can running on the same instance. This is basically to protect against the OM from Linux. Define volumes with size, especially on empty dir, so that you get guaranteed that you have the space and you can go until the space. Otherwise, you get could get evicted. And with us, with every container, make sure that your JVM parameter fits to the requested parameters, that you have sufficient space between them for the JVM overhead or for anything what you need to do off heap. And for a lot of stuff, really look to the stateful set in any way. If you need something which behaves more like a today Hadoop cluster or Spark cluster, look to the stateful set, which not only allows you that things get rescheduled and you get the same volume back, it also gives you deterministic DNS names and so on. That is solves a lot of problems also for other pieces. And now, because we say we only run one job, it's a question how much HA I really need for this job. So before I had a cluster and so on, so it could be even affecting more, and to be safe, you always work with multiple AZ zones. You have a lot of traffic goes back and forth, and this can be easily also raise your build. I have seen Kafka clusters where 50% of the build was network traffic across AZ because of replication things. And here you can say, okay, even if I well distribute my job, if I have an AZ failure, anyhow, between 30 and 50% of your job is lost. The question is it not easier to restart them? And then I'm only running them locally in one AZ and have the benefit to save cost and have lower latency because I don't have the latency across the thing. And the similar thinking is with ZooKeeper. If I run Flink or the Spark cluster in a half and use your ZooKeeper, is that really something what needs to be a ZooKeeper cluster then multi-EZ, really persistent, because it dies then anyhow. This is something where you can basically save also money and complexity. On Flink, it's really the newest release, 1.5, makes the running in Kubernetes easy on the way easier. This whole project Flip 6 will make this then running good, but with the current release, a lot of ARCA problems get solved. Then if you run in S3 on larger scale, I really recommend the talk from Netflix start of this year, because there's a lot of hints on how to do checkpointing, snapshotting, and dealing with performance problems on S3. And also a lot of hints which should be respected are in the Flink forward from Berlin last year in these things, where, for example, also said you should always run in HA mode, but have only one job manager, because it solves a couple of container problems for you. On a Spark side, shuffle is a thing. There's the option to externalize shuffling, that the pod can die, the executor can die before shuffling is done. But for our use cases, we figured out it don't make sense. It can be other use cases where it makes sense. This is something really you need to see in your own project. In other pieces, if you are in Amazon and have to use a lot of S3 stuff, is really looking to the right output committer. Otherwise, you get the instability. Because typically, as I said, we don't have HDFS by default available. Logging monitoring, the standard of Kubernetes is Fluentd to do the log file routing, which also allows assigning tags to things, which is for the multi-tenant very important. On the monitoring stuff, Prometheus is really the first choice. Everything around Kubernetes works smoothly with Prometheus. Even Prometheus can figure out where are the pods running and do the right scraping and so on. So there's a very good integration there. There are certain things, because Prometheus works in the opposite way as Graphite and all these others, where push, Prometheus pull. For a lot of stuff, you have problems end of job. You have to make sure that the last values also get scraped, or you use the push gateway. But the push gateway has a problem that it, by default, don't forget data. So if you not manually delete it or use a patch which apply a TTL to each value, that it, your push gateway will be, after some time, goes out of memory. Grafana works good for visualization alerting, and the other piece is also Kubernetes looks a lot of to health checks to make sure that the containers are in a good shape, and there you have to think about that you have good health checks. But you can also run statsd or something like this on every node. It's also easy to deploy in Kubernetes. As we had the challenge to run in Amazon, S3 was a real challenge for us in terms of scalability pieces. Is really this with the object name distribution is if you get bigger buckets and want to write in normal patterns, so you have a directory structure with date and everything, and then you go into one date directory, you likely only go to a few server, especially if you have a huge data set and you add something. It's because S3 see your whole bucket, every object name as a huge string list and partitioned by the string list. So you have to make sure that you really, really spread out to get the maximum performance out. And this is not only write, it's also read if you need run really good parallel jobs. And then there's also a good article about the output committer stuff. And then another hint, what I've also done on HDFS at some time, was to basically say I don't rely on anything which is in the directory. I maintain somewhere my own list of files or objects, and then you can make copies of it and you can change it, and every tool uses only this list. And so it allows you that you recompute stuff and they still seal the old stuff. And this is really something which helps a lot. And at some point, I hope that also this other project, S3 Guard or something like this, will start supporting there something. Because what S3 Guard basically is right now is doing, it start producing a Dynamo database with all the object names of your bucket to address some consistency problems of S3, which you don't have if you use HDFS. So as I said, we don't have HDFS for free, and at some point S3 drive you crazy, you need to think about stuff. And one thing what I basically said, okay, because we also create clusters on demand for Spark Flink, why not HDFS clusters, even temporary, that they're only for a few stuff there, because it's temporary data. So everything in your pipe, and at the end you copy back to S3, but in your normal pipeline you use HDFS to avoid all this consistency problems, and that other stuff works well. Basically the same pattern, say we do HDFS on demand, have also a helper up, and they can have a simple REST API and say, here, start it, stop it. And so it's also, even if you want to have persistence, but you only need it for 3 hours of nightly processing, you can during the day shut off, means you save at least the money for the EC2 instances. For the EBS volumes, you still have to pay for that. So it's, and there you can also then use stateful sets and so on. And yeah, if you don't need real persistence over time, then you can also work with local storage. And Amazon has right now really nice boxes where you have good SSD stuff in it. And then is also the next question, do you need AZ support, or do you run it in the same AZ as your job to save network bandwidth costs and latency? And there's also further work on the road that guys are, that there will be information shared to between HDFS and Spark that they can try to do something local. But I haven't seen this working. But guys are working on that. Then another piece to stream apps. Especially if you have patterns where your load between days and nights, you have a huge variance. You have on the streaming cluster always a problem. You have to size it in a way that it can handle the maximum traffic, because there is no easy way to dynamically scaling up and down. And what we had made is basically saying, okay, let us put the CPU and resource heavy part in an external service, put them behind a load balancer, and the streaming application only do the orchestration, send the request to that, wait for the result or whatever, and go then further. But then you only need constantly running the resources for the orchestration, but not for the compute thing. And this also would say you can run even this service then on spot instances, because they can die, then typically then also stateless. So it's really a good way to make the system more stable. And as Flink has this asynchronous way that they can join in information, this is something where here could be helpful to leverage. Yeah, so that's, I would say, thank you. And from all this stuff is really think different. Kubernetes changed a lot of things, how we have done in the past and how we can do it in the future. It's a different thinking, not only in the way how they're internally implemented, also in a way how you can use it.
So.
Any questions?
Anyone has a question? We still have 10 minutes, so if you want.
So, do you have experience with the Spark operator to run Spark on top of Kubernetes and to deploy these jobs?
We have done it. Currently the system is at this company where I've worked this, they run it now in production.
Okay.
And at the end, from the application point of view, it looks like a normal Spark cluster. It's really only the way how you do the deployment, and we have even done it. We started in this in a cluster mode, and the helper app really do basically a submit, a normal job submit to this temporary cluster.
Okay, so there's also a way to have a custom resource to deploy jobs as a Kubernetes object. Did you use this, or is the
No. We have done it by our own, because as we started that was not available. So this is basically, it was coming with Spark 2.3, and we used Spark 2.1 or something like this, and also older Kubernetes versions at that time. So and also because of the multi-tenant stuff, anyhow it would not sufficient. But for normal one user clusters or one company clusters, this currently what I mentioned to the integration in 2.3 is completely sufficient.
Thanks.
And it's the first version of it. In every version, they do more in it, that you can also do not much better customization thanks to that. The interface is there. Right now, the implementation is would be very hacky to do it. But I'm pretty sure this will be changing in the next versions. But for the most standard stuff, it works.
Thanks.
First of all, great talk, a lot of great insights. I would like to know more about your experience running the S3 Guard. We tried to run it using, because we face a lot of consistency problems with S3. We tried to run it at first, but we have a lot of performance issues and also problems with like Hadoop version, because the version that is necessary for to run like using S3 Guard is different than the default one with Spark, and there's a lot of different dependence problems. So I would like to know more. What's your, in the end, we gave up on running it, but I'd like to know your experience.
To be fair, we're also not running it in production right now. We also run, the team tried a lot of the things around. It is conceptual the right way, but as you said, it is more the practical pieces around that. And this is also why I basically mentioned it, and I also say the list object piece. Otherwise, you can also make it something like by yourself. And right now, especially on Spark, I would say use this other, committer, what I mentioned in the other link, to work around some pieces, and then also they created some HDFS.
Did you write your own S3 output committer?
No. There's a project also from a Netflix guy, which has written in Spark output committer, which works with S3 better.
Okay, I'll take a look.
So they're basically, the trick what they're doing is they're doing all the offload, but they don't commit. And only at the end they do the commit. So what you will see is that you have a lot of unfinished partial uploads on S3, because everything what not get done is still there, so you have to make sure that you have a cleanup setting on your S3 bucket for all older partial uploads. But this is basically the trick what they're doing.
Cool. Another question is, how do you use HDFS on your production environment? Do you, because we right now we like run everything on S3. But as you, I think you mentioned that you use like HDFS as an intermediate state, and then you send things to S3. How is your this workflow? When, how do you do it? Or
there's a Helm chart to deploy some data nodes. So we definitely we don't have data local. This is an advantage to have, but you can simple set up run an HDFS. Deploy it in a Kubernetes cluster, and then you specify the URL, and then you have always network traffic.
Cool. Thank you.
But there's also other thinking. So if you say you don't want to do this and you have a smaller data set or things like, you can also look to the Amazon Elastic File System piece. But there you have to really look to the credits, because you only get a certain amount, you have only the huge speed until you have the credits. So there's basically a trick what you need to do. You have to make your file system at least a certain size that you get enough credits. Because you can't, it's not like EBS where you can buy the I.O. Basically, you only get the I.O. by size. But it's also relatively easy to do. You have a job which looks, oh, the file system is too small, make it bigger, that I get sufficient performance. But it's important that you monitor these credits, because in the second that you run out of the credits, your performance goes dramatically down, as all this cloud stuff, which has rate limiting in some ways.
Okay, more questions? So thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.